The North American XB-70 Valkyrie was an ambitious supersonic bomber designed to replace the B-52 Stratofortress, capable of flying at Mach 3 and 70,000 feet. With six powerful engines and a delta wing design, it was meant to outfly Soviet interceptors and anti-aircraft defenses. In response to highly capable Soviet air defenses, the XB-70 was then developed to a certain extent as a lower altitude bombing option, something which did not fully evolve or prove very effective tactically. The reason the USAF was intent on replacing the B-52 was because the lumbering bomber was vulnerable to Soviet intercept fighters and anti-aircraft guns. So, to reduce the risks of intercept fighters and anti-aircraft guns upon US strategic bombers, the US set out to develop an airframe that could fly higher than the enemy could reach and fly fast than the enemy could shoot. However, while budget considerations always figure prominently, and of course there is no question about the long-standing value of the B-52 both during the Cold War and today, yet there also does appear to be an interesting argument to suggest that, indeed, the Air Force should have been allowed to buy the XB-70. A super high-speed, high-altitude supersonic bomber would arguably still have relevance today for a number of key reasons. First of all, a non-stealthy B-52 certainly cannot operate in a contested environment, and a faster and higher altitude nuclear bomber could multiply the threat equation for an enemy. Even if an XB-70 were somewhat vulnerable to air defenses, it might prove useful in support of stealth bombers or other assets as part of a campaign, and its speed and altitude would still likely make it difficult to target. By extension, even if it were vulnerable to some air defenses, it would clearly be much more survivable than a B-52, yet still be able to reject air power and carry a sizable payload. Perhaps the previous existence of the XB-70 could inspire thinking about a possible new aircraft in the future. Being from the 1950s era in terms of concept, it is not likely the XB-70 would prove extremely relevant today. However, upgrades to the 1962nd era B-52 will enable the bomber to fly for several more decades. A faster, heavily armed, high-altitude bomber concept is something which the Air Force might be well served to consider in the future as a nuclear air attack option somewhere in between a stealthy B-2 or large, vulnerable bomb truck like B-52. However, as the utility of intercontinental ballistic missiles ICBMs grew, the Valkyrie's role diminished. Only two prototypes were built, and one was lost in a tragic collision. The program was ultimately canceled, serving as a reminder of the complexities of military innovation. In Norse mythology, the god Odin used DA group of maidens to sift through the slain after battles. The maidens were charged with deciding who amongst the slain were worthy of a place in Valhalla. The maidens were known collectively as Valkyrie. Centuries later, when North American aviation needed a name for their cutting-edge prototype, a strategic bomber capable of reaching supersonic speeds, they chose Valkyrie in reference to Odin's maidens. The North American XB-70 Valkyrie was a unique bird with distinct features. With six engines and a delta wing design, there was no mistaking the Valkyrie, which was billed as the future of strategic bombing. Initially, the XB-70 designers employed what was known as the brute force concept, which conceived of carrying as much fuel as possible for long-range subsonic flights, and of using an aerodynamic shape that was crafted for high-performance sprints. In order to achieve and maintain these high speeds, their XB-70 was actually designed to ride on the shockwave it produced at supersonic speeds, using a delta wing slab-sized fuselage and a large triangular intake on its belly, positioned well ahead of the bomber's engines. Yet, only two Valkyries were ever built, and the bomber, named for Odin's maidens, endured not as a symbol of U.S. air supremacy, but as a cautionary tale to exercise budgetary discretion. The XB-70 prototype was meant to lead to the B-70. And get this, the B-70 was meant to replace the then-new B-52 Stratofortress. Obviously, that didn't happen, but wound up dissolving into the realm of history on display at the National Museum of the United States Air Force. But the XB-70 wasn't meant to be, competing not just against other bombers, but against newly devised intercontinental ballistic missiles and submarine-launched ballistic missile systems. The utility of the XB-70 wasn't always clear, with a primary mission of swatting down nuclear-armed Soviet bombers before they got too close to American territory. The Rapier would have been expected to cruise at Mach 3 and 70,000 feet and hit an altitude of 100,000 feet in a zoom climb, burning exotic zip fuel, which produced much more energy on combustion than normal jet fuel. Each of its engines would put out around 30,000 pounds of thrust, a little more than the F-100 PW-229 that powers today's F-15X, albeit optimized for high-speed, high-altitude flight. As for the missiles the XF-108 was intended to carry, the GAR-9 was a member of the Hughes Falcon family, but was considerably larger than its cousins, with a length of over 12 feet. By comparison, the GAR-1D and GAR-3A Falcons then in service at the time were around 6 and 7 feet long, respectively. The GAR-9 had been specifically developed for the Long-Range Interceptor Experimental LRIX program, for which the XF-108 was selected in 1957 as the winning design, being chosen ahead of the rival Republic XF-103. Originally intended to carry a conventional or nuclear warhead, the GAR-9 would have had a range of 100 miles or more, flying to its target using semi-active radar homing. With the engagement process being managed by the ANASG-18 fire control system on the Rapier, design changes to the GAR-9 increase its weight and diameter, leading to modifications to the XF-108's weapons bay, although it's unclear if the rotary mechanism was changed in the process. Ultimately, however, despite good progress in the development effort, XF-108 was canceled in 1959, with the Air Force failing to find the funds needed to keep the program alive, despite its promised performance. Moreover, the concern about Soviet bombers was beginning to diminish, now that intercontinental ballistic missiles ICBMs appeared to pose a much graver threat. It would be left instead to convey F-106 Delta Darts to defend North American skies against bombers, a job that they did well into the 1980s. A similar fate befell the XB-72, this being canceled in 1961 before any examples had been flown. The reasons included developments in Soviet surface-to-air missiles, which were expected to put it at risk, as well as the appearance of cheaper nuclear-armed ICBMs. Despite the demise of the XF-108 program, work continued on the GAR-9, which was redesignated as the AIM-47 in 1963. It was now intended to arm the Lockheed YF-12A, the interceptor version of the A-12 spy plane, which performed several successful test launches of the AIM-47 before it too was canceled. Thereafter, the AIM-47 and ASG-18 helped inform the design of the AIM-54 Phoenix and ANAWG-9 radar that, as part of the F-14 Tomcat, ensured air defense of the U.S. Navy carrier battle groups for much of the Cold War. If you enjoy content like this, please go ahead and like and subscribe to this video because I appreciate all your support.